All right, how's everybody doing today? In this section, A2, we're going to take a look at using properties of parallelograms. In the video after this, we're going to take a look at section A3, which shows you that a quadrilateral is a parallelogram. So all the properties we're going to use here in section A2, we're going to actually do the reverse of that in section A3. So these two sections kind of go hand in hand. A lot of teachers will teach these two sections together. So let's get into the four properties of parallelograms. Parallelogram is a quadrilateral with both pairs of opposite sides parallel, which means a lot of times you'll see a diagram where you'll have like a little triangle symbol on each line. So those opposite sides are going to be parallel, and then so are these opposite sides. So both pairs of opposite sides are going to be parallel. Now, with that said, there's going to be characteristics of parallel lines we're going to bring into our discussion here. Now, there's four things. If you know that a quadrilateral is a parallelogram, then there's going to be four things that are always going to be true. The first thing is that opposite sides are going to be congruent. So in addition to being parallel, so you have opposite sides that are going to be parallel, those opposite sides are also going to be congruent. Now, sometimes a diagram will get really messy, so I'm just going to kind of clean it up here a little bit and just mark each side with a congruent symbol. So this side and this side are going to be congruent, as well as this pair of opposite sides. So that's the first characteristic of a parallelogram. One of the other characteristics is that opposite angles are going to be congruent. So this angle and this angle will both be the same, as well as this angle here and this angle up here. Opposite angles are going to be congruent in any parallelogram. Now, this one is going to make use of our parallel lines. If I take a look at the angles, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 angles in a parallelogram. Now, any consecutive angles, now consecutive, that means that they're right next to each other, they're in a row. Any consecutive angles are supplementary. And you have to remember that the word supplementary means that their sum is 180. So any two angles next to each other that are consecutive, they add up to 180 degrees. Now, my very last characteristic about parallelograms, the diagonals, they bisect each other. So that means if I go from here to the other side and here to the other side, where they meet, they're going to bisect each other. So that's going to chop each one of these in half. So we're going to use those four characteristics here momentarily. Now, to find the values of x and y, now our diagram's already marked for us a little bit, so we can tell that it's a parallelogram because both pairs of opposite sides are parallel, which means I'm going to first make use of these two angles right here, 65 and y. Opposite angles in a parallelogram are equal, so that means y has a value of 65. Now, one of my other characteristics, opposite sides of a parallelogram are equal, which means x plus 4 is going to be equal to the side that's 12. Now, when I subtract 4 from both sides, I'll end up with x equals 8. So I get a value for 8 for my x, and my y has a value of 65. That's it. Pretty straightforward stuff. Now, in our second example, now we're going to have to play around a little bit here, a little bit more. We've got four different things to find. Find the indicated measure given that JKLM is a parallelogram. So they tell us a parallelogram, so we're going to have to make use of those characteristics. First thing that I want to do is take a look at NM. Now, NM is this piece right here, from here all the way to this spot. Now, I know that from N all the way to K, that part is 2, which means the NM part also has to be 2. So NM, that's got a value of 2. Now, from K to M, so now I want the entire piece. So I want this whole part from here all the way down. So if I know each piece of that is 2, that means the whole thing is going to have a value of 4. So KM is going to be 4. Now, for example C, I've got to find the measure of JML. So what I'm going to do is kind of redraw it a little bit, just to kind of help me see some things in here. Now, I know all of angle J is 110. Now, JML is going to be this entire angle right in here, that whole spot. So what I'm going to do is I know that consecutive angles in a parallelogram are supplementary. And if I know that basically angle J is 110. Well, this missing piece, well, that's got to be 70. And I get that because I do 180 minus 110, and that gives me that 70 degrees. So the measure of angle JML, well, that's just 70 degrees. No big deal there. Now for part D, I've got to find the measure of angle KML, and this one's going to be a little bit more work because check it out, I'm going to use what I just found, and I know this whole thing right here is 70, but this miss, and I know part of it's 30, so that means that this missing piece right here, well, that's got to be 40 because 40 plus 30 gives me 70. So the measure of angle KML, that's just 40 degrees. And that's it, I'm done. No big deal there. So hopefully you came up and understand all four of those examples for number two. Now, number three, I think you could probably do on your own. What I want you to do is set up an equation for each piece and solve each piece, first finding the value of A and then finding the value for B. So if you think you got this down on your own, hit pause and then come back and see how you did. So how'd you do with that? First, you'll set A minus 12 equal to 30 because opposite sides in a parallelogram are equal. Then when you add 12 to both sides, you get A equals 42. Opposite angles in a parallelogram are congruent, so B plus 10 equals 36. Subtracting 10 from both sides, you get B equals 26. I'm sure you guys rocked that out. Now let's take a look at our next example, example number 4. Now here for example number 4, we got to find the indicated measures of triangle of parallelogram ABCD. First example in A, we got to find measure BCD. So BCD is this angle right up in here. We got to figure out how much all of that is. Now there's a couple of different ways you can do this. Here's one of them. One of them, I can start down here with this angle of 37 degrees. Now because two parallel lines cut by a transversal, I've got alternate interior angles are congruent. That means this angle 37 is going to be the same thing as this guy up here. So this entire angle now, I know that angle is 137. So let me kind of redraw this here like this then. So I know this angle is 137. Well, angle BCD, which is the one I'm trying to find, because I don't know what that angle is, those two angles have to be supplementary. And if they're supplementary, that means they add up to 180. So 180 minus 137, well, that's just going to give me 43. So the measure of angle BCD is going to be 43 degrees. Now, I could have done that a little bit differently. Instead of going after it from that perspective, I could have done the same idea but said, if this angle is 100, I know that this angle right here is 100. And then I'd have 137 in this corner down here, basically where angle D is. So again, I'd use that same property, consecutive angles. So these two angles right here have to add up to 180. And then I would just subtract 137 from 180 to come up with 43 degrees. So either way I do that, I end up with 43 degrees for the measure of angle BCD. Now for part B, it says that BE equals 9. So let me write that in my picture. So from B to E, that's 9. I've got to find from B all the way to D. Well, what do we know about diagonals of a parallelogram? They chop each other in half. They bisect each other. So that part and that part, both of those are 9. So from B all the way to D, well, that's easy to add up, and you can do that mentally. BD has a value of just 18. That's it for this entire section on A2. Where we use properties of parallelograms to find missing pieces within the parallelogram itself. In the next section for 8.3, when we go ahead and do that, now we're going to be taking a look at the same ideas that we just did, but we're going to kind of do it in reverse. We're going to be given a quadrilateral, and we're going to have to prove that it's a parallelogram based on those four properties we just used. So more on that in the next video. Be sure you tune into that, and I'll catch up with you guys then. Peace out.